How do you account for the fact that you guys are still together and so many groups have broken up over the years? You still have your act together.
It's still economics.
Is it?
No.
No.
Seriously. It's a family group. They're three brothers, cousin, friend, next door neighbor.
Good friend, Al Jardine.
Yeah. That's marvelous.
Yeah. That's
kind of marvelous. Were there a lot of dry periods in the 15 years? Because everybody thinks of the Beach Boys as only the guys who've been on top all those years.
No dry periods in the Beach Boys. Surfing all the time.
No, you know
we
what
do
I'm
have
about.
Up and we've had up and down cycles, but I think that's natural. You know, nature has a cycle.
Sure.
7 years of famine, 7 years of feast, and all that kind of stuff.
We're going to talk some more, but we're at a crucial point in the show. A thing called Station Break is about to come upon us. So can we
that's
get you
important.
To sing?
That's
can we get
important.
You to sing now?
Me?
Yeah.
Sing.
Sing.
From all these people.
Oh. Okay.
Talk about the new recordings. What actually are you doing in the studio right now?
Well, we're basically working on new stuff. 15 Big Ones, our current album, has about half and half oldies and newies. We call them newies, new songs and old songs, classic songs, you know.
Hey everybody, welcome to another Dumpster Dive video, and today I'm going to be talking about one of my favorite bands, and I am not above talking about my favorite bands on these episodes. I've already done the Monkees. I love the Monkees. I did the Doors. I adore the Doors. And today I'm doing the Beach Boys and this steaming pile of dog shit known as 15 Big Ones, and I apologize. I just want to apologize right now to Dog Shit for comparing you to this album, but it was the nearest comparison I could make. But anyway, this is 15 Big Ones, called 15 Big Ones because this was the Beach Boys' 15th year in existence, and there are 15 garbage tracks on this piece of crap album. So how did this album even come to be in the first place? So the Beach Boys were everybody's favorite surf, sun, and fun band in the early 60s. The Beatles came to our shores, and there was a competitive race between the Beatles and Brian Wilson in terms of production and songwriting. Brian Wilson came out with the masterpiece Pet Sounds, and the album Smile was set to be released in 1967. However, Brian Wilson had a breakdown and lost confidence in the project, abandoned it. The Beach Boys had a precipitous decline in commercial fortunes in the late 60s, started to win back some of their fans in the early 70s, and in 1974, Capitol came out with a greatest hits package, a double album hits package called Endless Summer. And America was already undergoing a wave of nostalgia in the wake of the George Lucas film, American Graffiti. So everybody was rediscovering all that great music, and the Beach Boys found themselves with a huge selling greatest hits album. And lo and behold, the Beach Boys were cool again. Beach Boys records were selling. The Beach Boys were a hot item once again. It was time to record their new album, and Brian Wilson, after the Smile album, his participation in the production and the recording and the writing of subsequent Beach Boys albums, it was very much hit or miss. Depending on his mood, depending on how inspired he felt, he might contribute 1, 2, 3, 4 songs, or he might contribute very little at all. And so this was promoted as Brian is Back. There was an entire Brian is Back campaign, which was entirely capitalizing on the Endless Summer greatest hits package, and also all the goodwill that people were feeling towards the Beach Boys again. So they needed to go in and they needed to record an album. Well, Brian wanted to record an album of oldies. And Mike Love and Al Jardine did not give a shit. They just wanted any old product out there to take advantage of the Beach Boys' newfound popularity. Dennis and Carl, to their credit, were like, wait a minute, let's slow this train down. Let's actually put out an album that we can be proud of, an album that will continue to progress on the records that they had been putting out in the early 70s, which, while not up to the standards of the 60s, the mid-60s Beach Boys, they were still enjoyable albums, well-played albums, had some good songs on them for the most part. So they did not want to just throw out any old album very quickly, slapdash, thrown together. Well, unfortunately, Mike Love and Al Jardine won out. And what they ended up doing is a hybrid. They had some new material and then they had some oldies covers, just because that's what Brian wanted to record. This was his first time back in the producer's chair since the Smile session. So there was a ton of hype about this album. Not just because the Beach Boys were suddenly so popular, but people could not wait for new Beach Boys product. And then this piece of garbage hit the stands, and it was a case of be careful what you wish for. Let's start with the cover. They couldn't even do a group photograph. They had to take the Olympic rings and throw these pictures of the Beach Boys looking very sheepish and embarrassed. Brian Wilson has long, greasy hair. Al Jardine is so embarrassed, he can't even look you in the eye. Dennis Wilson looks stoned. Carl Wilson looks indifferent. Mike Love has this shit-eating smirk on his face. The only thing good about this cover is the logo. The rest of it is as bland and tacky as the songs on here. I don't even know where to begin with this album. Very seldom do I get as emotionally charged over a shitty album as I do this one. And that is because I love the Beach Boys. I love the early Beach Boys, the mid-60s Beach Boys, the late 60s. Kind of lukewarm about the early 70s Beach Boys, but this is so disappointing because the Beach Boys were capable of so much more, and they put very little effort into this album. The songwriting was rushed, the production is terrible, the songs are weak and embarrassing. And you just get the sense they don't give a shit. They don't give a shit. They should have just as well called this album, Give Us Your Money. And there are people who will tell you the Beach Boys put out worse albums than this one. Yeah, they did, probably. Summer in Paradise. But Summer in Paradise, that was the late 80s, early 90s, somewhere around that period. They didn't know any better. They were already past their prime. They were just trying to keep current with the trends, which had left them far behind. With an album like that, it's like they didn't know any better. But with this album, there is no excuse for this being a pile of garbage album. And yeah, as a band, they were fracturing, they were arguing. You had Mike and Al Jardine, the transcendental meditators on one side. You had Dennis and Brian, who was the partiers. Brian was doing a load of cocaine, chain smoking, smoking pot, smoking whatever he could get his hands on. Dennis was already a full-blown alcoholic, and Carl was sliding into alcoholism. So it was not the best time for the band. But still, there are bands who have recorded albums under a lot worse circumstances than the Beach Boys were in. So I'm not giving them a pass on that one. But for Christ's sake, this album sucks. So very unfortunately, I have to get into the songs on this album. So it opens up with a Chuck Berry cover, Rock and Roll Music. Now, I'm familiar. My favorite version of that is the Beatles version from Beatles for Sale. The version that we have here is so lame, so limp, so uninspired.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Dance with me.
It's basically synthesizer, bass, and drum. There's no life to it. Even Mike Love can't drum up enough energy to make this song even remotely listenable. The next song is It's Okay. It's Not Okay. It sucks. And what kind of a title is It's Okay? Name me another band that has a title as weak as It's Okay. The lyrics are weak. The playing is weak. And this is, I'm going to say this. The Beach Boys had some of the most beautiful harmonies in the 1960s. Heavenly harmonies. Brian Wilson used to spend weeks, months building up harmonies. He had such an ear for harmonics. And to hear what passes for harmony on this album, it's really a caricature. It is. If you've ever been to an amusement park and you see those kids who are making below minimum wage and are singing show tunes for all the blue hairs who are too old to ride the roller coasters, that's the quality of the harmonies that you have here.
Gotta come to it.
It's terrible. The Beach Boys are a shell of themselves on this album, and it extends to the harmonies. The harmonies are so weak. They're the most basic harmonies. There's not any effort put into what is their stock and trade, their voices. Anyway, It's Okay blows. Had to phone ya, for fuck's sake. What rhymes with California? Had to phone ya? I can't even. The pun is so lame. Again, the lyrics are ridiculous. The arrangement is stupid. The song is stupid.
Had to phone ya. Had to phone you just to talk to you. Had to phone you just to tell you I was missing you.
Stupid. Chapel of Love. Embarrassing. They should have been embarrassed.
Go into the chapel. Chapel and we're
what the fuck are you doing covering Chapel of Love? And yeah, it's as terrible an execution as it was in theory. Everyone's in Love with You is a goddamn soap opera theme. It's Mike Love on vocals. Mike Love is not a ballad singer. He's barely a rock and roll singer. His vocals on this album, to call them substandard is an understatement. So what the fuck he's doing singing this song, I have no idea. It's terrible. It's the worst piece of crap, syrupy sweet ballad. Even Davy Jones thinks that they overdid it on this song. The next song, Talk to Me, out of all the cover versions, this is the one that I hate the least. You have a great Carl Wilson vocal, and it is a cover of an R&B song from the late 50s. I think it was like Little Willie John or something like that. But so it's a good song. Carl Wilson gives it a great vocal. The production on here is not awful, so this is probably the song that I hate the least. The song that I hate the most follows it. That same song. And I'm telling you right now, I am not trying to be funny when I say this song is one of the worst songs ever written. Not just by the Beach Boys, but the worst song ever written by humankind.
Well, back in time with just a rhythm and rhyme, Gregorian chants were a real big thing. They took that chant and added harmony. It was a different sound but had the same meaning. I know,
I know,
I know,
I know.
It took us a long while to go,
to go,
to go,
to go,
and find us a rock star.
Do 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 do. The Beach Boys try to turn in a gospel number, and the song fails on so many levels. The lyrics are juvenile. The production is irritating. It's harsh on the ears. I can't imagine anyone even liking this back in the 1970s. It's annoying in every sense of the word. It's almost like it's trying to be deliberately annoying. The last song, I said, holy Christ, are we still on side one? Yes. The last song on side one is the TM song. How many fucking songs about transcendental meditation does Mike Love have to shove down our throats? Two albums later, they actually titled the album after transcendental meditation. It was called the MIU album. The Maharishi International University. Mike Love, no one gives a fuck about transcendental meditation. And the people who do are probably not Beach Boys fans. TM song blows. Side 2 kicks off Palisades Park. This version sounds nothing like Palisades Park. And I mean that in the worst possible way. You have these lame Beach Boys harmonies, a lazy vocal. The song is awful. And who thought this was good enough to release on an album?
Run, 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 and now the rides are running. Run, 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 and now the rides are running. Last night I took a walk in the dark, a sneaking place called Patterson's Park, to look around and see what I could see.
Susie Cincinnati is the next song, written and sung by Al Jardine. Now, this was a holdover from the Sunflower Sessions, which many people regard as one of the Beach Boys' finest albums. The reason why I didn't make it on that album, I'm not going to go into here, but it does pop up here. No, I'm not crazy about the arrangement. I'm not crazy about the song. The song is okay. It sounds closer to classic Beach Boys than much of the other stuff on here. So it's not an awful song. This is probably my favorite song on the album. And by favorite, do I like it? No. But it's not as terrible as the other 14 songs on this record. And I can't go into the rest of the songs. I cannot bring myself to talk about A Casual Look, which is another Lane cover. Blueberry Hill, another god-awful cover. Back Home is not interesting at all. It's like a Color by Numbers. It's almost like a Beach Boys sound-alike band. And that's the problem. All these songs sound like Beach Boys sound-alike bands. In the Still of the Night, Who Cares? Just Once in My Life, Who Cares? Who Cares? Anyway, I'm not being, sometimes I'll ask the question, am I being too harsh? I am not being too harsh. If anything, I'm not being harsh enough. This album pisses me off. Fuck. All right. Anyway, if you have had the misfortune to hear the album, if you actually own this album, why do I own this? Like, I'm a completist, but why do I own this album? Anyway, let me know your thoughts on the album. Maybe you'll like it. Maybe you'll love it. Let me know in the comment section. I gotta go take a shower.